announcements. First of all, this afternoon, things are going to be a hair different. We have planned a youth and Olympian activity to go roller skating, which all of you were invited to participate, to come to, and to just go up there and take care of, and join me with us. And the prices are there in your bulletin that was passed out. Micah, we have a heavy ring. I know you're testing something else there, but
I'm trying to fix it.
Okay. All right. So that means no services here this evening. We're still doing church tonight, but we're doing it together out there, having fun and an activity of fellowship together, okay? But no services here tonight at the church. And then don't forget some of the other things that are coming up down the road. Oh, by the way, choir practice will be immediately following the service. Please, be as fast as you can. I don't want to keep you here long, and I don't want it to be the type thing to where you feel like you're staying all afternoon and then trying to come back for something else. Come straight downstairs, which, by the way, means I will not shake hands at the back of the room. I'm not being rude. I'm going to walk out this door. I'm going to grab my book. I'm going to go downstairs, and I'm going to be ready to sing immediately. They're already down there, okay? So the books are downstairs. Just go right down there. You're going to start singing right away. And the goal is to sing through the songs just to make sure we're not letting them, since they're newer to us, letting them slip off of us a little bit, and then we're not ready for the next Sunday morning, our walkthrough, okay? So choir practice immediately following the service. Be prompt so we can be quick to get through it and finish and move on, okay? Now, don't forget on Good Friday, we have Good Friday service instead of Wednesday that week. And don't forget that we'll have that at 7 o'clock on that evening. And then once we get to the Sunday morning Easter, we'll have, let me make sure I got this right in my head. 7 o'clock is sunrise, 8 o'clock is breakfast, 9 o'clock is egg hunt, 10 o'clock is service, which will include the choirs at the top, okay? So 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock. What?
Don't hit this. No, we don't.
All right. Soon got to get back to using this, so I don't have to worry about that podium. All right, let's see. You have some information there for you about that. Take note of the VBS decoration sessions down on your calendar there. They're all very important. Also of a youth outing and hike on April 25th. Continue to pray for Brittany concerning her preparation and upcoming trip. And no, we do not have an answer. As of yesterday, word had not come back to Brittany on how much had come in, so we do not have an answer. Did not call her this morning, but we'll let you know as soon as we do. Hopefully the fact that we haven't heard in the negatory is a good thing. So continue to pray about that. And that was one of Brittany's deadlines, though there will be more that we will end up letting you know. I apologize it came through the prayer chain, but it came through the prayer chain because even though John and Judy and I kept saying we needed to make announcements about it, I never did. I never did. I never did. And then I never did. 4 weeks in a row. I never did, right, John? Then Judy says, it's here. We never did. We better do it this way. So, there it is. All right. I think that's it on those type of announcements. I'm getting used to reading the format we have here today. A little different. So, choir practice immediately following. Okay, now we have for you Easter breakfast sign-up sheet. If you're coming, we prefer to have you sign on here so we can have a general idea of how many are going to be here so we know how much to prepare. And again, this is at 8 o'clock in the morning. We'll have an Easter sunrise service at 7 before this. And then at 8 o'clock, We'll have our breakfast, and so please sign up. Let us know if you're coming.
Andrew.
Yes.
Be one of the few times. You don't need to bring food. Just show up.
Don't need to bring food. Just show up. Right. And the fellows, you're planning on still having the fellows help you get it together on Saturday. And you'll let us know what time you want us, like noon or something?
12 o'clock.
12 o'clock, okay. All right, 12 o'clock on the Saturday between Good Friday and Easter Sunday morning, okay? So keep that in mind as well, okay? Have I forgotten any other announcements? All right. Now, it's good to have with us here today, Arianna's friend, and Arianna, we'll have you introduce her. Stand up and turn around. Say it loud.
Caitlin's fine, too, so she's
Well, yes, Caitlin's fine, too. They're all buddies together.
Arendelle.
No, they didn't hear you in the back.
Arendelle.
Arendelle. It sounds like she's from... Lord of the Rings or something. Hello, Arendelle.
Aaron.
Oh, it's Aaron.
Someone's
oh, okay. All right. I'm sorry. I had to do that to you. All right. Let's go ahead and start singing number 518, 518, oh, it is wonderful to be a Christian.
Let's all stand.
Thank you.
this time we'll have our gentleman come forward to take up our offering.
My gosh, gentlemen. He's confused.
I need to continue to pray for Ryan's. Not able to feel up and out. We need to remember to pray for them. It's also his birthday this week. So not easy when you're not able to do the things you want. So keep that in mind. Maybe give him a ring and send him a little something. Say hi to him and tell him you miss him. Well, look at this surprise. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
It's been a long time. All right, and remember to pray for Miss Marlene as she's facing with chemo coming and trying to deal with her cancer there. Continue to pray for Miss Cass and her healing. Also remember to pray for Bonnie and her housing situation. And yes, Candace.
Can I, Father, for prayer, his friend, his co-worker, Brian Bogulis?
He's going in for a second hip replacement. He's only 42. Miss Shirley's healing and doing very well. We're pretty pleased with her results there. And up and around and just doing amazing. So, and don't forget to pray for also for Charlotte Duff and Jim. They were down this past week, and her dementia is growing, so we pray for her with that as well, and him as he tries to help and encourage her during that time. Okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for our opportunity to be here together. We thank you for the special blessing it is to worship you in our gifts and offerings and our tithes. We thank you for the blessing that you've given to us of all the health that we have to work and to do the things that we do. Lord, the country we live in where there is so much plentiful around us. And Lord, we know that you are the author and giver of all things, that you own it all. And we're thankful that you have entrusted us with what you have. We pray that we enjoy and willingly worship you today. And we thank you for all your blessings. Then, Lord, we bring to you this list of requests. Lord, there are many in our midst who are dealing with sickness of some type and been away, but also we pray for Miss Marlene with her cancer returning and the coming chemo, for John Shippey, and Lord, the surgery that he has to have here for his aneurysms. And Lord, we pray that you would help with that, and that this would be something that they could find a better way to prevent it. We pray for Brian Fabulous, who's going in for this hip replacement. We pray that you'd help him, and that this one would take and do better, and that you would also make this an opportunity to witness and to be a difference maker in his life. We pray, Lord, that you would be with the Ryans and Mr. Leo, especially with his birthday and not being able to get out the way they like and dealing with this pain. And we also pray for our dear friends and loved ones, the Duffs, and pray that you'd help them as they deal with this time in life, one that we expected, but Lord, one that's never easy for us, humanly speaking, to deal with. I pray that you'd give the grace and mercy needed. We thank you for all that you do and how much you love us and watch and take care of us. We pray, Lord, that you would just bless us today as we worship you in Jesus' name. Amen.
And all
little people singing, huh? I forgot to do this earlier, but if anyone didn't receive the prayer chain, Mike can hand it out to you. Make sure that you get it. You didn't receive the prayer chain so that you know who you're to call and that kind of thing. Please raise your hand. We'll make sure you get one.
Andrew,
yes.
Something that I forgot to announce. Doug and Kelly Blackston's house on Loman Lane and Union Bridge will be available for rent soon. Just wanted to announce that so everybody knew.
Okay. So pray for a good renter for Doug and Kelly Blackston, their house on Loman Lane. Thanks, sir. All right. I'd like for you to turn to Colossians chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2. We could also look at Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to look at Colossians chapter 2 today. How many of you have ever done any type of sewing, knitting, any of those type of things? Okay? I have done some sewing, but I don't know that you would call it sewing. I could probably figure it out, but yes. Dangerous thing sometimes to put a needle. Anyways. When you sew something, what are you doing? What are you doing when you sew something that's ripped? Or when you're knitting, what are you doing when you're doing that? Isn't it that you're combining, in many cases, combining two parts together and locking them in one to another? Isn't that the idea of what you're doing? When you're knitting, you're taking various yarn, thread, whatever, and you're, I don't know what you call all that stuff. You take it and you mix it together in the right way so that it locks and holds, right? That's the idea that we're going to look at today, the thought of knit together. And what does God mean by that we're in a group here that is knit together? Okay? By the way, when you have something knit together, the imperfections are what make it extra beautiful, aren't they? The things where we hold on to one another even though we have our little blips of the wrong color and so on and so forth. It's what makes us wonderful together. Many of you would use your Afghan over any other blanket you have in the house when you're sitting down to watch TV or read a book or even sew something else. You just like those type of things, right? But read with me Colossians chapter 2. We're going to pull out of verse 2 and verse 19. We'll start there and then we're going to work through the whole chapter quickly on a flyover basis. Verse 2 says, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ. And verse 19 says, and not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered, and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. You ever heard this statement? I'd lose my head if it weren't screwed on. Okay, please look at these verses and say to yourself, that's exactly what God is telling us, that we are knit together so we don't lose our head, our hands, our eyes, our feet, so that we can be the body we ought to be. But before we really dig into this chapter today, I want to look at the word knit. It's actually sum devazo. That's how you would say it in Greek, sum devazo. Not that you care about that, but here's what it means. To drive together. Would you agree that in knitting, that's exactly what you're doing? In sewing, that's exactly what you're doing? You're putting two things and you're driving them together. Okay? So it means to drive together. To unite in association or affection. Mentally, it infers to show or teach. Show or teach. It's translated typically throughout the scriptures as our word, knit, also compact, a assuredly gathered in trust and proved. But here's the interesting thing. When you break down this word and you take it apart, you look at the first part, it's a couple words put together. Then the first part, soon, means a much close union. The soon part on the beginning means a much close union, with or together. The special note in your Strong's and your Vine's would be that this is unlike any other union in the Bible. This is not an ordinary union. It is a much close union. Okay? Keep that in mind. The beginning of the word says a much close union, to drive together. And when you sew a knit, isn't that exactly what you do? You tie them together to where it's a much close union. All right? Sometimes you even bury it so far into it that it seems like they've become one of each other, right? The next part, biazo, the second part of the word there, means to force. But here's where it gets interesting to me. It means to force or crowd oneself into, to press. To crowd everything into one area, to press. To force all into one spot, okay? In the passive voice, it means to be seized, in essence, to suffer pain, to suffer hurt. Someone else grabs you and forces you somewhere. So we're not looking at the passive side right now. We're looking at the active side, which means to force or the crowd. But then you see that biazo is based on another word. And its root word means to force through vital activity. Now, some of you don't like it when I do the Greek, and I don't do it all the time, but if you are paying attention to what we've just built, just in the word alone, there are so many building blocks there that help us to see how God wants us to be to each other. Okay? It comes down to that God wants us through vital activity, doing the things that are vital to our Christian faith, to see that God is forcing us together in a way, by choice, by the way, it's our choice, because it's not seized upon us, it's by choice that we've chosen to be led by God and put into this position, and God is allowing us to make the decision to force our lives to intersect and to be as one, to be a part of each other, and to tie us together in a much close union that is driven together in such a way that we are united in association and affection. That's what God says. Now, look with me at verse number 2 again. We'll go back and pick up 1 in just a minute. Let's pick out now 6 things, as I look through this passage, 6 things that being knit together brings to us. Okay, 6 things. And you might be able to find more in this passage, but we're going to look at 6 things that being knit together by choice, being forced into the same spot and close association so that we learn to love and care for each other. Verse 2 says that their hearts might be comforted. What's the first thing I see that we get from being knit together? Comfort. That makes sense, doesn't it? Look, when you're cold, you like having things that are knit together around you that cover all parts of your body, right? Have you ever had one of those vests that didn't have the arm on it? And you've been outside when it's freezing and you wished you had the arm on it? When you're missing something, it's not very fun, is it? Now, there are times that it's just that right temperature that's a perfect thing to have, right? But I'm talking about when you think about comfort. What does having the whole body there do for us? Provides comfort. What does having the whole body knit together do for us? Provides comfort for each other. By the way, what should we be providing for each other? Comfort. It's not easy. Some of us have big quirks. They make it hard to make it comforting. Because we've grown up with a problem, or we've struggled with something, or we've got an attitude. But you know what? We're not talking about here, by the way, the idea of encouraging them to make bad decisions and do bad things. We are talking about comforting one another because we're here. There is nothing more comforting than when someone goes through a problem that other people come alongside and put their arms around them and take them in. Nothing more comforting. Why do you think it is that we run to mom when we fall down? It's on our knee. Why do we do that? Because it's comforting. But the church ought to be united in such a way that that's exactly what we are. Comforting. One to another. If you're hurt in some way, we should provide comfort. You're cold, we should provide comfort. You're in need, we should provide comfort. You come here today, even though at times you'll be uncomfortable because your toes are stepped on. This room should be a room of comfort. There is a way to fix the problem. There is a way to be right with God. We ought to be a part of helping each other find that. That's what the body does. Okay? So comfort is the first thing. Then we have our statement here, being knit together. We might be comforted being knit together in love. And so the second thing I see is that we have love. Because we're knit together by this love. We talked about that last week. When you love one with another, love covers a multitude of sins. Does that mean that everybody gets to get away with everything in the family? No. In fact, when you're a good, strong family, you tend to help each other more through love deal with your problems. It's the family who is weak who says, I can't talk to my brother about this, who get mad. It's the family that's strong that can allow for it in love dealing with each other. Listen, we need to realize that the second thing we get by being knit together, by choice, being forced into the same family where we're united in such a way that we are sharing everything, a much close union with vital activity. When we do that, it needs to be based on love. And love ought to be what we're given. You know what happens, though, in Christian circles? You're forced into a tight space. You don't like it, so you start elbowing, right? Move away. Give me room. Right? And the end result is, we're not providing comfort or love, are we? When it should be, we all want this together. Let's crowd in and be the same. Right? Now we got two sides to this. There are some who get in the middle when they are constantly throwing elbows. There are others who stand on the outside and never get involved, shoot arrows at everybody on the inside. Those are both problems when it comes to a family. Both problems. Because we ought to be knit together in love. Which means, get involved in the family. Get in there. Rub shoulders with one another. Iron sharpening iron. Do you get the idea that it means that we share more than just 1 or 2 or 3 or 5 or 6 hours a week? Yet, unfortunately for all of us in this room, we live in a society and an area where 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 or 6 hours a week is about all we can spare to spend together. Right? You and I need to realize the importance of uniting together in such a way that we're providing comfort one to another and love. Let's look at the third thing. Still here in this verse. It says, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding. Unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding. In a moment, we're going to see what the understanding really centers on. But before we build all the way to what the understanding centers on, let me ask you this. We realize that part of being knit together means you have to have understanding. You have to have understanding of what the other person will do and will take. Right? If I know that my wife does not like it when I mock her, as in repeat what she says with her voice and my imitations, and I do imitations. If I know that, should I do that, Amy? Should I imitate your voice? Let's just say it's not a good idea. Why not? Because that pushes a button that is beyond all buttons. Don't push that button. Don't mock and imitate with the exact voice. So guess what Andrew's learned in his married life? Don't do it. Don't do it. You know what? We learn more and more and more about each other the more time we are together, don't we? And the more we learn about each other, the more understanding it should provide. Oh, that person is this way. So let's give them a little room and let's pray for them. So that could even be some bad things. It could. That person craves praise. Detrimental amount. So they take praise when they don't deserve it. You know what? What does it matter? We're a family. I told you that I have a problem. A problem with somebody that can push my buttons, can aggravate me. Not from this church. Okay? I was talking to or spending time with someone else in the group, the family, the setup that we're talking about. And this person said to me, "Why do you worry so much about proving you're right with that person? You know, the fun for them is getting you to argue with them. And the rest of us know that you're right. So why do you do it?" Now, I could come up on the spot with a lot of different excuses, but the more I thought about it, the answer was, I shouldn't. I should learn to keep my mouth shut and not worry about the fact that they're trying to goad me into an argument. Who cares? Who cares whether I help them to see that they were wrong and I taught them the error of their ways? Because let me just tell you, the person that I'm trying to teach the error of their ways, they don't care whether I think I won the argument or not. And in their eyes, I never win the argument. So why even try? Why not just be understanding? See, that's the idea of knit together and close and caring about each other. And maybe we can have a much better relationship because I won't take the bait to join in the fight. It changes the way you think about things when you're dealing with each other. And it's a real struggle in Christian circles because we really, a lot of times we're about comforting, number one, me. That's what we're about. We're about loving, number one, me. We're not about loving others. And we're about understanding how we think it ought to be rather than understanding what someone else is dealing with. Now again, part of the problem that you have when you're a family is you got one person on the inside who can start throwing elbows. It's too close in here. I don't like it this close. You're in my space. And you got the other person who stands on the outside and says, "Nobody let me in." They're shooting arrows at everybody when they're the ones who are having a problem too. This comes from not getting it right. Knit together means by force, choosing to by force be united. Yes, I said that. Choosing to by force, vital activity, get united. Understand. The next one. Look at the same verse, verse 2. To the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. So what is the understanding centered on? What God has done in our lives. Okay? It's centered on the understanding of what God has done in our lives. But also, folks, it is based on acknowledgement of the mystery of God in someone's life. You see, when you're knit together, you understand the fit of the entire process. And so what do? With each other? You acknowledge that God is still working on each of us. Jim and I were talking the other day on the way to the wonderful tax people. We were talking about the idea of he's still working on me. He's not finished yet. You know, it would go a long way if we would say that about each other. We tend to say, oh, that person did that on purpose. Rather than, you know, I'm still working on them and I need to pray for them. You see, a knit together says, not, I'm staying over here and rip. It says, I need to give a little bit. Help them. Why? Because I acknowledge that there's a mystery of God and what he can do in the heart of someone. Again, listen. I'm going to keep emphasizing this. Because I deal with it a lot with people who, they're in my space. Well, good. We ought to be in each other's space. They never include me. Well, maybe you ought to just allow them to include you because I see on a regular basis people asking you to do stuff. And you say, no, I'm not doing it. Well, then what in the world? You can't have it both ways, people. It's either we're going to do what God says and be united by force, choice, to allow God to tie us together, or we're not. You can't have both sides. What God wants is for us to be tied in such a beautiful way by vital activity. So, acknowledgement of what God's doing in our heart. Now, we're going to jump to verse 19, and I'm going to give you the two things, and then I'm going to do a flyover the whole chapter and put it in context for you, okay? So, verse 19, two more things. We've got comfort, love, understanding, and acknowledgement of what God's doing in the life of someone. Those four things happen because we're united together. Now, we're going to look at number five in verse 19. And not holding the head from which all the body, by joints and bands, having nourishment, ministered, and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. The two things I see here. Number one is nourishment. Look, you can't hold one part apart from the body. They all have to be united. You can't have one separate piece. It doesn't work that way. And if it's not united, you either lose it, or it never works properly. When I go out in the snow, I like to have something, boot-wise, that comes far enough up my ankle that when I push my jeans down over them, it would take an awful lot for the snow to get up into my jeans and down into my boot. I do not like snow in my boot. I get made fun of by my family because I like to wear moon boots, as they call them. The big fluffy ones look like the Michelin Man. You know. You know what I'm talking about? I like to wear those because they're just big enough that where my jeans go down, it goes right over the outside and no snow gets up in there. Okay? You like it when things fit together snugly and perfectly because what happens then? It's protected, right? It's comforted, it's love, it's understanding, it's acknowledgement. But listen, what happens in the body if things are no longer attached the way they ought to be? Let's say, for instance, let's say that you get diabetes. You do not take care of your diabetes. And it does the things that it does to your body and your organs, and it makes it to where it can no longer get the correct nourishment to the foot, which happens to a lot of diabetic patients. What must be done? It must be cut out, or the whole body will die. Did you know that? That's why you see a lot of diabetics missing limbs. Because their body, with the organs and the attack that the diabetes has brought, is incapable of providing nourishment everywhere. Listen, the best way for a church to be healthy is for it to be united in such a way that the head's not separated from everything else, the hands aren't separated, the feet aren't separated, as the beginning of the verse says there, and not holding the head from which all the body of the joints and bands having nourishment ministered. It's not just one little part, it's the whole thing united together, and what do we get? Nourishment. We get encouragement and nourishment. We get fed. You realize that if we are doing what we should as a church, it shouldn't be that there's a star at the top and all the streams go individually to every single person. As in, the pastor is the one that holds us together. No, that's not what it should be. It should be all of us knit together, and all of us making sure that each other are getting fed. All of us. So, it means someone over the years stands up and says, we don't have a children's program here. I have been thinking about going to another church at least for that service so that I can take my kids for children's program, but God's laid on my heart that maybe I ought to start children's program right here. That's being the body. Or someone else comes in and says we need to have a bigger impact in our culture and in our area. We need to teach some of our young people to learn, to do Bible clubs. I remember a family that used to do that with young people. All over Tawny Town, they used to have them, didn't they? Young people used to learn. It's great to have a body that is nourishing others around them. That's what God wants. And the last one is, in the verse there as well, it says, and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. So what's the fifth thing, that or sixth thing that I see that happens when we're knit together? We increase. Everything grows. Not just a few. It grows when it's tied together. When we all are getting the nourishment we need, we all will grow. You see, God wants us to be united in such a way that we are driven together by choice. We chose to be a part of this. God's led us here, yes. And we chose, we said, yes, I want to do this, and God's knit us together. And now from that choice, and from what God has done, where it's not been seized upon us and forced upon us, but instead, we've said, yes, God, I will follow your will, and I will be joint here. And in that, we have a much close union with each other together. To where vital activity has made it to where we're close. Then the end result will be comfort, love, understanding, acknowledgement, nourishment, and increase. Look with me at verse 1. Time for a flyover. I'm going to go fast now, because this is just going to tie it all together using the whole chapter. For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh. He says, my heart aches to see you. I wish that I could. Some of you have never even seen me at all, and I just really ache to see you. Okay? That their hearts might be comforted, being knit together. How does he think they're going to have comfort? Being knit together. And being in love. And unto all the riches of full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ. He wants them comforted because they're knit together. In love. He wants them comforted because they're knit together in understanding. He wants them comforted because they're knit together in love and understanding and acknowledgement of who God is and what He has done. Verse 3, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge? When we are knit together in God, guess what we get? All the things that are hidden in God, all the joys and pleasures and peace and everything that God alone can provide. It's right there, but it comes from being knit together, and we find it in God. Verse 4, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with the enticing words. Don't let someone draw you away from this family or make you think something different than what it ought to be. Let it be the family that God has drawn you to, and let it be your choice to allow Him to force you to become like the body and a part of this body. Okay? Verse 5, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the Spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. Paul says, even though I'm not with you right now, I still am a part of your body. And I enjoy it. You see, you don't even have to be here. Jim Duff, for whatever reason, on my mind because he's been down for these couple of days dealing with something, can go back to Pennsylvania, but say in his heart, I really miss you guys. This is my church. Yes, I have a church up there and I like it, but this is my church. That's what it ought to be. Verse 6, as ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in Him. Live up to doing what God has asked us to do. Walk in Christ. How do we do that? Best way. Being unified, comfort, love, understanding, acknowledgement. Eventually, nourishment and increase. Verse 7, not only are we to walk in Him, but to be rooted and build up in Him and established in the faith as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. So we should take what God has put into us now, and we should be rooted in it. Again, instead, what happens is people get in there and they say, this is too close for comfort, and they start throwing elbows, or they stand on the outside and they say, nothing like good, man. Which is it that God wants? None of those. God wants us to be a people who says, I have chosen and been directed by God to be a part of this body. Force me to become it. Take me there, God, and knit me into the group. And how do we achieve that knitting? By participating in vital activities. Folks, I'm just going to throw some things at you. If you stay home when we're doing the cleanup day, you're missing out on an opportunity to be locked in with your brethren. You got it? If we're having a fellowship meal, like a sunrise breakfast, and you're not traveling somewhere to where your heart aches to be with us, and you don't come, I don't like it when other people prepare food. Men especially, no, I'm not. Whatever your reasoning is, the honest truth is you're missing out on an opportunity, a vital activity, where you have said, this is where God called me, join me together. See, every time you're not here when we ought to be meeting together, every time when you're not doing the things that you ought to be doing, and then participating in the areas you ought to be participating in, whether it's going on an ice cream trip, or going over somewhere to go roller skating. We are missing out on vital locking together. Because vital activity locks us into the tent. Yes, this is vital. This is the number one activity, okay? Don't misunderstand me. But I'm trying to tell you, there are many things that we could learn more about each other and enjoy more. There are some ways that you can get around some of the weaknesses that you have in how? By making sure you invite other people to your house on a regular basis. By going to them and taking them meals. There are a lot of things we should be doing that lock in this stuff that we're talking about. And it comes from being rooted, built up in Him, establishing what He wants to do, and seeing that that's where we ought to be together in this family and together. Look at verse 8. Beware, lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after the tradition of men, after the rudiments of the world and not after Christ. He keeps reminding us that people are going to want to tear us away. Oh, my heart breaks for the people who have been torn away, whether by their own decisions or by other people's prompting. But I believe I'd want them to still be a part of this body. I'm heartbroken for them. I'm heartbroken that the comfort and love, and in essence, in most cases, they themselves cut off the nourishment. Sat in the pew for a while, acting like they were being fed, but not being fed. And eventually, didn't increase, but died away and went somewhere else. I'm sad. Someone's vain philosophy could cause such a thing. You and I know this has happened a couple of times, hasn't it? Over the last 20 years, people step away with love. But why? Oh, Pastor, this man. No, you don't want to come on now. Why? The real answer, why? And I'll tell you, it has to do with right here, what we're talking about. Verse 9, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, that's Christ, and ye are complete in him. How do we get to this level where we really want to be? Well, it's being knit together in him. It's us realizing that he's the completer that makes us worthwhile and finishes the deal in us. So what should we be focused on? What should we help each other achieve? Where should we be taking each other? To the completer, which is the head of all principality and power, in whom also are ye circumcised, and the circumcision made without hands, and putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. It's like God has cut away the sin in you, okay? Buried in him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of our operation of God, who had raised him from the dead. He buried your sins and you're risen again. You see, if we acknowledge that these things are happening in each other, then we're going to be more tolerant of the problems and weaknesses that we need to grow through, won't we? But I'm sad to say, in many cases, when people have even left our midst, it's because of the unwillingness to acknowledge the weakness in someone else and to care and to be understanding and to love them and to provide comfort. There are times we could probably do better on this end as well. You and I must understand the call that God has given to us here. Let's keep going. And you being dead, verse 13, in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. Again, if we in being knit together will focus on the fact that we were dead in our sins, but he quickened us and made us alive, what are we going to think about each other? They're dead in that sin right now. They're living in dead. But I know God's in their heart and he's working on them. So what's going to happen? He made better. And I want to be a part of fixing it. Not a part of stomping it down. Right? So we should care about each other, not pound each other. You should understand and have acknowledgement of what Christ is doing. Absolutely. That's what all of this chapter is teaching us. Verse 14, blotting out the handwriting of the ordinances that was against us, our sins, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. Jesus dealt with it completely. He didn't say, I'll deal with it to a certain point, then I'm sick of that person. He dealt with it, and he nailed it to the cross. I'm going to tell you, it is very difficult. I know when people rub you the wrong way. Very difficult not to just write them off. But I'll ask you this. Does Jesus write them off? And having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. God took from them what they had, and he's made a show that he is victorious. He is the one. So let's turn to God, and let's look to God. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of any holy day or any of the new moon or of the Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ. In other words, and I know I'm flying over this, but I hope you understand, you're knit together of Christ. So don't let people pick you off and make you do things that have nothing to do with Christ, or were the picture of Christ, or seem to be religious, seem to be a religious idea. But instead, be knit together and working on what God has taught. Because so often, they're telling us they can't eat meat offered to idols. And if that church is doing that, they must not be. Look, some Christians do that with things like music. And music's offered to idols. And if they're offering it there at that church, it's offered to idols. Praise the Lord. That old church is going to hell. You don't know that. And you don't have a right to judge that. It's wrong, folks. We're united together, knit. Let no man beguile you of your reward in the voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. People come with their own fleshly mind, they come up with all these ideas, and they're puffed up with it, and the end result is they make very bad decisions. Again, I have seen it on a regular basis. Not just in this church, but in many churches. We should not be so caught on our own ability to think that we forget that God is uniting us together, and that is vital to our work and growth. Let's go on, verse 19 again. And not holding the head, from which all the body by joints and hand and bands, having nourishment, ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. Wherefore, if ye be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why, as though living in the world, are ye subject to ordinances? Touch not, taste not, handle not God's examples, which all are to perish with the using. After the commandments of the doctrines of men, don't listen to all their little things, their rules. Don't worry about all the things the Jews tell you about, how many steps you can take on a Sunday or a Saturday. Don't worry about all those things. Serve God. It's pretty much what he's telling you. Which things, verse 23, have indeed a show of wisdom in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. God wants me to come down. Let's read that again. God wants me to come down. Which things have indeed a show of wisdom in all and in will worship and humility and neglecting of the body, not in any honor to the satisfying of the flesh. These things have a great opportunity, and they do a great job of teaching us to not nourish, but instead to worry about separation. A favor. I'm all for the idea of being separate, come out from among them and be separate. But that's not what God means, what we churches have been doing to apply it. We are knit together. Close. A closer union than any other union. Forced to vital activity. So here's what you need to learn. First of all, there's some things we need to change, and if you're not being nourished or increased, maybe it's because you're standing on the outside and or you're standing on the inside. Get away, get out of my space. And instead it needs to be, we're a body. Let's get close. Let's get to know each other. Let's do these things together. Second thing is we need to make sure that we're about this business, not about ourselves, but about the business of comforting others and loving on others and understanding others and what God's going to do in them and acknowledging God can do it and then making sure that we feed those around us and we help them increase. That is the responsibility of the unity of the church. Are you willing to do it? Hopefully we've set up James for next week. As he comes in, he's going to speak to you on this subject and close out our little series here on, Lord willing, better say that, Lord willing, he's going to close out our series here on unity next week and preach to you and then also tell you his heart for the ministry and what God's doing for him and where he's taking him. But in the meantime, you evaluate these things in your heart. Come before the Lord, every head bowed, every eye closed. Just a moment, we're not going to take long, but I just want to, just a moment. There's someone here who says, Pastor Andrew, I do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, but I'd like to know a Christ who wants this in me. I'd like to accept Him. I'd like to ask Jesus to come into my heart today, right where I am. I promise not to embarrass you, but would you just raise your hand? I'd like to ask Jesus to come into my heart. Christians, as we sit here together, I'm not going to preach the sermon again. You know what you need to work on. The Spirit's been touching your heart already. The question is, are you willing? And maybe right now, at this altar or there in your seat, you ought to give it to the Lord.
Feel much warmer when we're put together. As loose threads, we are worthless. We thank you, Lord, as you knit us tightly together, we could become a valuable fabric, so tightly woven that nothing will stain and the world will be repelled. We ask, Lord, that you will help us to understand the value of being knit together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Bye.
Fire,
let's go.
Yeah, he knows. He'll be here.
I'm good.